Good evening and welcome to the third LILA PRISM lecture this year. We're very happy that you're continuing your collaboration with IIC. This is the first lecture here. We've been having it at the IIC and here. This is the first lecture here this year, this season. This evening we have Ritu Menon. She'll be talking about biography as continuity in the series. The series is titled Cultures as Continuum. This is actually a sequel to the last year's series, which was on development in India. So we were thinking about how there was this question of how development is not inclusive, it's not really touching everybody. So we're thinking of how to balance this view, and you know, so that we don't become very cynical about this. And so this series feature 14 speakers from various cultures, various areas. They are mostly practitioners who really know the pulse of various areas. So this is called Cultures as Continuum. Ritu is speaking about biography. She's exploring this space, biography, as a continuous, discontinuous space with reference to her work on Nayanthara Sehgal. And we have Arunima here from the School of Social Sciences at JMU. Apparently some people live their lives in more interesting ways than others. And their personal histories become kind of integral to the larger story of their times is made. So I think there is that kind of a continuity about their lives. And when somebody else, in another time and space, starts to write their life, there is yet another kind of continuity. So we are exploring the biography as that kind of a space where we have lessons, visions of continuity. I don't want to elaborate more on this. We have Arunima here. Arunima is with the Women's Studies Center at JNU. Her own work is varied, very varied. It ranges from visual culture to faith practices, aesthetics, modernity, aesthetics, a lot of things. She's got a lot of awards and fellowships in these areas, especially in her work in Kerala, in these areas. I welcome Ritu and Arunima to this evening, and I request Arunima to take the seat. Thank you.
Thank you, my role, fortunately, is only to introduce Ritu, and she really doesn't need an introduction, and then tell you a little bit about the format of this talk. She will speak after that for about 40 to 45 minutes, and then we open the floor to questions. To most people here, there is absolutely no need to introduce Ritu Menon. But for those of you who may not know her, the off chance that somebody here doesn't. For those of us who know her from the 80s, we remember her as the co-founder of the first feminist publishing house in the city and the country. She was the co-founder of Kali for Women alongside Urvashi Bhattacharya. And in the last 30 years or so that I have known of her and known her, Ritu Menon is a feminist activist, a writer, and a publisher. And she has done all of these things in these three decades, which is quite an extraordinary thing. And she has a wide range of publications which sort of touch on questions of gender and violence, on issues of memory and identity. And I must say, for me particularly, because I have actually read this several times and taught it, Borders and Boundaries, Women in this Partition is a book that I have learned enormously from and value greatly, mainly because it actually did a variety of things. It actually put the question of partition and memory on the map of, I'm trained as a historian, on the map of Indian historiography. So it actually changed the way in which we actually thought about Indian nationalism, in which we thought about memory, and how we actually think about history itself. So I think that's a landmark work. which brought together a range of different kinds of things, from memory, history, women's voices, how to think about narratives, and so on. And I think that Out of Line, which is Ritu's biography of Nayanthara Sehgal, is in a very interesting way in keeping with the concerns of that earlier work. So may I ask you, Ritu, to speak about it?
Thank you very much. Thank you, of course, Rizzo, for bullying me into doing this. And thank you, of course, the IIC, which is an old friend, an old partner, an old colleague. We do many, many things together, and it's always a sheer delight to be here, of course. And thank you, everyone, for being here. And of course, Arunima, that very, very generous introduction. Thank you for that, and I hope you will keep me in line because I don't have a watch. I'm going to, you know, Arunima mentioned the sort of different kinds of things that I've written, and perhaps I should say that I don't like to do anything twice, meaning it, researching and writing on an issue, if I have done it once, I don't really like to revisit it. So people keep asking me, aren't you going to do anything more on the partition? And I say no. Because I think unless I have something very, very different to say about it, I don't want to repeat whatever has already been done by others, but also that I might have tried to do. And so it is with several issues that I've done some work with Zoya Hassan on Muslim women. I don't want to repeat that either. So for me, it's quite important to keep some sort of research as well as activist, as well as personal sort of compelling need to write about something or to research it before I do it, because I don't have a stake in it either, meaning I'm not an academic, so it doesn't make a difference to my career. I'm a publisher and I deal with other people's writing, so it doesn't really matter whether I write or not. But of course, I have to say that having been part of the movement, part of the women's movement, and having had to engage and having wanted to engage at a very deep level with several issues, things sort of throw themselves at you that you then appropriate, or then you sort of embrace, let's say, if we don't want to use the word appropriate. And so it is with biography. I have, as a publisher, but also as a reader, because I have actually grown up on biographies in many, many ways. I remember spending evening after evening in libraries reading biographies. But as a publisher, I have felt, and as a feminist publisher particularly, that this is an area which has been least explored by us, by historians, social scientists, anthropologists, writers, everybody. We publish memoirs. We've published quite a few. We publish autobiographies. We try to publish biographies, but there are not too many around, too many good ones that people are... I mean, there's a kind of reluctance. I'll go into that a little later. Now, I'm going to try and link what I have to say with the theme of this series, which is continuity. Although it was a bit difficult to see how it worked, but then I think I found a way. And to link that with the biography that I have written on Nayanthara Sehgal, a very well-known writer, a very well-known figure in our lives, in our history, in our literary landscape. And then, you know, try to open it up among ourselves to see if we can explore this space, as Rizzo said, and see what we can come up with. There are, of course, many kinds of, I mean, the most obvious kind of biography is the biography of an individual, let's say. One, a particular individual becomes the subject of an exploration, an examination, an inquiry, a recap, a kind of, perhaps even a tribute. And that is the most common of the biographical forms. But there are other biographies. There are biographies of collectives. There are biographies of movements. There are biography. There's even a biography of the novel. You know, if one can imagine that. And some years ago, an activist publisher and as a feminist publisher, I thought it would be interesting to see if we could do a biography of the women's movement. Now, it's very difficult, and as someone said to me, it's almost a contradiction in terms. I mean, the women's movement is one that does not believe in iconizing anything or anybody. So to do this for the movement would be a kind of anomaly. But I thought, no, there is a historical need for something like this. There is a way by which a lot of these histories disappear, they vanish, people don't recall them. And so it's a good idea to see if one can do it, but how does one do a biography of a movement? And one of the things that I thought might work was to get specific women across a range of let's say, types, that I don't like to use that word, but if you know what I mean, to write a memoir and to write about their engagement with the movement, but through that to actually try and arrive at some kind of a record, a document, but a record that was both personal and political. We did manage to get about 25 women to do that. It was very, very interesting because, in a sense, it sort of it illustrated both the pitfalls as well as the real sort of value of being able to do something like that. The book was called Making a Difference, and I must say it was a challenge. But it was a first step, and maybe it will be developed further by people who are willing to take that challenge forward. I think it's a very, very important thing to biograph movements, and it's not, especially the social movements that we see happening in the country now and have been seeing for the last at least 50 years post-independence, and so it seems to me a valuable endeavor. But, you know, among the many challenges that biography poses, perhaps the most difficult is that it isn't taken seriously. I found it quite difficult to persuade people, historians, social scientists, anthropologists even, although anthropologists might be more inclined because they deal with what they call ethnography, but is actually life history, to attempt it, to actually think of it as a serious project. For a long time, it was considered to be, this is worldwide by the way, it's not unique to us. So for a long time, it was considered to be little more than journalistic gossip, which is to say journalists wrote biographies. Serious people didn't think that it was something to take seriously, as I said. Then it became largely hagiographic, and that's how it continues for the most part, at least in India, to this day. And although of late, that is to say, let's say the last 50, 70 years across the world, it's become a little more respectable, it is still something of an anomaly. And it's an anomaly because it doesn't quite fit anywhere. It's not quite literature, and mostly it's not history. It's not fiction, although the form that it uses is a narrative form. And of course, it's not part of any discipline. There is no way that you can actually study biography. It has no disciplinary pedigree at all. But it is a genre. Even if it is an underdeveloped genre, it is a genre. And as a genre, It has some, I think, some quite particular aspects, and I will mention just a few so that we can talk about it a little more later. So, by its very nature, a biography is simultaneously about the past as well as the present. It is written in retrospect, from where we are placed now, in time as well as in space, about a life or lives that recede by many decades into a time and a place that may be quite forgotten. So to speak of a biography as continuity then is to recognize this simultaneity, but also and equally to know that it must engage with discontinuity. That discontinuity, which is an intrinsic and almost an inextricable part of every life, and is therefore part of its telling. Which is to say that if we don't see these two as being interlinked, then that telling in a way is partial. This is also why, one reason why there can never be a definitive biography. There can only be one version of it, an attempt, either well and sincerely made or not, because each biography carries the impress of the time and context in which it is written, the cultural baggage of that time, and the consequent interpretation of the life being written about. It carries what has been called an impress of the intellectual present. Now, that of course is something that the biographer has to take on board and make a conscious part of the writing or the telling of that life. And as biographers, we are actually caught in that same process of time from which we seek to rescue our subjects, which is to say, we seek to make them present today, to bring them to life today. I mean, you can imagine if you were writing about somebody who's been dead and gone 100 years, the challenge to make them part of your present is fairly major. In my case, of course, Naitara Segal is still very much alive and wonderfully so. So it was slightly different, but that has raises its own problems. There are other, I'll come back to that continuity, discontinuity in a bit. But there are other contentious, or at least difficult issues. The separation of private and public in a subject's life, the general convention, the usually accepted convention, that the personal should not find mention in a biography, is no longer as assiduously observed as it used to be, but there is still a reluctance about revealing intimate details. In several of the comments on this book on Out of Line, one of the things that emerges is how immediately people fasten onto the personal as just personal. Meaning, it doesn't really matter how much you say, look, the personal is political, the personal is literary, the literary is political. What remains and what is caught onto and fastened onto, as I say, is the personal. And so, although that reluctance to dwell on the personal or the private, as it is also sometimes called, is no longer as great as it used to be, there is still a lack of clarity on how much to reveal and in what context. For instance, if your subject is no longer alive, should family members be taken into consideration? If she is alive, should your manuscript be vetted by her? Should she be given the option of, of modifying it? If she does want it modified in some way, which changed or elided, should you agree? Should you acquiesce? Is this part of the contract between a biographer and her subject. How much does one select of what is first private, and then how it is to be shared? How does one arrive at this process of selection or omission? How do you decide what is relevant to the life that you are recounting, and how much of it is just of incidental interest? Do the details, do these personal or private or so-called intimate details, reveal essential clues to the subject's character or development, or do they not? And so on. Now, the thing is, of course, all these questions arose in my mind as well, obviously, especially because Nayanthara Sehgal is still alive, and she was, I had her permission to write. I also had access to all her material, unconditional access to all her material. But apart from that, you know, I'm a feminist, and a feminist publisher and writer and researcher. And so the question of whether or not to write about the personal was not should I or shouldn't I. Of course I was going to. But of how much space this would occupy in the story. And what of it I should emphasize. The question of emphasis is a very important one, is a very critical one in a biography, and it is one that is often observed in the breach. More often than not, I would say it's observed in the breach. I also had to decide very early on how critical the personal, in this case, Nayanthara Sehgal's personal life, how critical it was to her political and literary life. Which is to say, how critical was that to the choices she made, to the trajectory of her writing, as well as her politics. Now, in as I said, you know, in the case of Nayanthara Sehgal, it was actually not such a difficult decision, because here is a subject and here is a person whose life, whose politics, and whose writing are actually inseparable. It is not possible to separate the you can separate the strands, but if you don't see them as intertwining and as linking up one with the other, you would get a very, in my view, you would get a very incomplete life. You would get a life that did not do justice to some or other very important aspect of the person. Now, she's, of course, there were other problems. She's very well known. She comes from a very high-profile family. She has written extensively. I mean, here is a, actually, here it, this was a problem. Here is a person who not only comes from a very high-profile family, which is very well known, which is often called the first family of Indian politics, but a woman who has actually written about every single important thing in her life. She has written autobiography, fiction, non-fiction, letters, essays, political columns, political biographies of her cousin. She had a well-publicized, very well-known falling out with Indira Gandhi. All that is in the public domain. It's all very well-known. In some ways, her life was an open book. So what was there for me to say? I mean, what was there that I could bring to this life that she, as a writer, as a politically prescient, politically vocal and active commentator, had not already put out into the public? So, clearly, there was some sort of, I don't know what word to use, I don't want to call it gymnastics, but the image I use is that of a kaleidoscope, actually, that the pieces remain the same. But every time you turn the kaleidoscope, they fall differently. And so I thought the challenge really is to see, if I turn the kaleidoscope, how will the pieces fall? And is there some way by which I can actually write a biography, that will present her in a way that she has not been able herself to make known, without being prurient, without being sensational, without being, without sort of laying her open to a voyeuristic kind of, a voyeuristic gaze, which of course would be completely anathema to anything that I would want to do. So, for the purpose of this evening, I mean, I can go on talking about that forever, but I won't. But for this evening's discussion, let me try and see how I sort of brought together this discontinuous continuous, the continuity and discontinuity, with reference to her life. And as we go along, I might sort of explain a few choices that I made in the telling of it. It became very clear to me, very, very evident at the very outset, that Nayanthara's life was lived across a historic divide. The division is very important in this discontinuous continuous, this hyphenated sort of time. The historic divide, of course, was 1947, the freedom movement and independence. A divide that she lived across. She was born in 1927, so at 47 she was 20 years old. Not only had she lived on both sides of the divide, but she had been critically engaged as a member of that family, of the Nehru family, in everything that happened pre-independence, at least for as long as she was a young woman and lived in the family and in the context that she did. So her first 20 years were a sort of ringside seat of the freedom movement, but one that was experienced in a deeply personal way. You can imagine, I mean, her parents were more often in jail than out. Her father died in jail because of pulmonary illness, because the Brits wouldn't let him out. It let him out enough to get medical treatment. Of course, her uncle and her cousins and her own sister also in prison. So this was not simply something happening out in the in someone else's life. It was very much a part of her growing experience. So lived personally. There was, as she says, there was a tight fit between the family and the freedom struggle. But it was also her political legacy. And so in her life, it was a crucial signifier. So it was, it became for her a very significant, it was a lodestar for her. Personally, her own great divide was also in 1947 when she gets married. She's 21 when she gets married to someone whom she has known only for 2 weeks. Now, she embarks on a married life with somebody whom she barely knows, and it, as we know, because she had already written about it, she had written in the mid-90s about this marriage of hers. It became the first and critical moment of rupture. Her marriage also marked the first critical discontinuity in her life. It marked a discontinuity in her emotional, her personal, and her political moorings, because from a life lived as one of struggle for a cause, which is freedom, she entered a world of complete domestic containment. There was no politics in her married life. In fact, nothing could have been more different from her own personal experience of living as the life she now embarked on. She Boxwala's wife. Her husband worked for SIBA, a Swiss pharmaceutical company which was setting up in India. Very interesting, it was the first of the non-colonial companies. Now, that had another kind of interest, but I'm not going to go into that now. But here he was a Boxwala. He worked for a foreign company, he had an extremely visible social life. It was nothing but socializing, partying. And as she said, when we talked, she said, I went from a world of orange juice where people said I was with so-and-so in prison to cocktail parties and vacations in Europe. She said, I had nothing to do with that life. It was not some... She said, I never knew that people could go to work at 9, come back at 5, and lead a normal life, because for us, normal was going to prison and coming back. So she had no idea of this 9-to-5 existence. Now, what has this got to do with what, you know, writing her life? I decided that I was not going to begin the biography with her childhood, because A, she had already written about it in Prison and Chocolate Cake, which became a kind of, I mean, it's sort of a almost a, I don't know what word to use, an iconic growing up kind of book. And she wrote about, she had already written it by the time, when she was in her early 30s, by the time she was 35, she had already written its sequel, so she had two autobiographies under her belt by the time she was 35. But why did she begin writing? She began writing precisely because she was so dissatisfied with her marriage. And that's why I say that that divide in her personal life, which coincided with the historic divide in the life of the nation, became the subject of her first book, which was her autobiography. Now, this was an autobiography that was quite different from women's autobiographies that have been written in India, in many of the languages, since the early 20th century. This was a very different autobiography. This was an autobiography in which this young woman wrote her life as centrally located in the life of the country. She was not separate from it. This was not some private, anguished account of her on her own. She located herself squarely in the life of the country. So the two things in a way aligned. Now, everything that she wrote after this, fiction, political writing, non-fiction, and so on, was an attempt not only to document these discontinuities, both in her life and in the life of the country, and I'll speak about that, but to try and reconcile them. This is a very important factor, I think, in if you're writing the life of a woman, and I will say this quite confidently, of course feminists have been talking about this for a very long time, but this, the struggle to reconcile is a very, very major part of most women's lives, whichever area they may be in. I'm not saying it's not a part of men's lives, please. I don't want to be reductionist in that way. But what I'm saying is that this attempt, this endeavor, is almost a permanent feature of most of our lives. There are exceptions, I'm not denying it, but I'm saying that as a sort of norm, it's a very familiar, very recognizable aspect of our lives. So what does she do? What does Nayanthara Sehgal do in this attempt to reconcile? She chooses to remain in an unhappy marriage. Also a very familiar compromise that people make. She chooses to remain in an unhappy marriage, and she remains in it for 17 years. Not a small amount of time. Not only is it an unhappy marriage, it is a physically abusive marriage. Also, she has also written about all this. she retrieves something of her earlier immersion in the political life of the country by making her fiction and later her political columns its vehicle. Her fiction and her writing becomes the medium through which she articulates her own politics, both personal and ideological. And she decides that in order to write politically, she will have to make India her central concern. Her main character, she has always said, is India. And if you see the range of her work, it is very evident that every other character is secondary, is ancillary. The central figure is the country. Just as the country had a pre- and post-independence life, and her fiction actually traces what happens post-independence in the country, she too had a before and after marriage life. Before and after independence, before and after marriage. Both are mirrored in her novels and in her political writing. So that element of continuous, discontinuous is there from the very beginning. And it remains there. She's one of the few writers in which this relationship is sustained to the very end. She's not at the end of her writing, but it has remained consistent throughout. But she is also now caught up, if she's writing politics, she's caught up in relations of power. And she says, and I will quote, "You see," she said when we were talking, "politics or political events have formed the background of my novels, and politics is essentially about power. But power is also the equation between men and women, or between men and men. It's the equation in all situations, whether domestic or political." So in her novels now, she begins to trace that gradual but unmistakable decline in public life and in political values, in moral fiber, a slow dilution of all the things the freedom movement had fought for. For her, this became a disturbing discontinuity. The first four novels that she wrote, the first four, are a very clear and a very unambiguous telling of this decline, this gradual but unmistakable shift away from what she thought and she believed were the values of the freedom movement. The second major break, the second divide, the second discontinuity that occurs in both her life and the life of the country is in 1967-69. In her personal life, through her divorce and the end of a 17-year marriage, in the country, with Indira Gandhi taking over as Prime Minister and beginning a momentous break within the Congress as it had been till then, signaling a radical departure for the country from politics as it had known it earlier. These became watershed years for her, for Nayanthara, and watershed years in the life of in the political life of the country. She, for about 14 years, she wrote a political column, and she was probably the first woman political columnist in the country. And for about 7 years, she wrote no fiction. She wrote but didn't publish. Her main writing was her political columns. She commented extensively and every fortnight on Mrs. Gandhi's policies, on what was happening with the government. She took her on, she challenged her on, let's say, on the nationalization of banks, she challenged her on the abolition of the privy purses, she challenged her on several political and economic developments of the time. And then, of course, she challenged her on the imposition of the emergency. At the time, when Mrs. Gandhi declared the emergency, and prior to that, Jayaprakash Narayan had asked Nayantara Sehgal if she would report for his weekly called Everyman's. And he said to her, will you go to Bihar and start writing? And she did. She wrote for a very long time for Everyman's. She reported from Bihar. She traveled there. And of course, she then joined JP's movement and continued to be vocal and active and engaged. And she wrote particularly about the abandonment of consensual politics. This became for her a very great betrayal of what erstwhile Congress politics had stood for. She says, a political way of writing, I'm quoting, a political way of writing for me was a very fundamental thing because one had been denied freedom of speech. She's speaking about pre-independence. There was very real censorship then during the British regime, a degrading and humiliating experience to have one's mouth shut. To write politically was the only way for me to proceed. So for her, her foray into writing was not so much an exercise in self-expression or a young woman's dabbling in the realm of the literary. It became the medium she chose in order to fulfill a clear purpose, communicating an idea of India in an idiom inflected with an Indian accent, presenting a perspective that was counter to prevailing and received wisdoms, presenting, moreover, an account of an alternative politics. So I would say that, at least as far as I can tell, or as far as I think, she is among those writers like Doris Lessing and Nadine Gordimer, who wrote their country from an experience of colonialism. To write one's country, as she said, without affectation, without being patronizing, writing with what she called, quote, a certain tenderness, is perhaps a woman's way of writing her country. But essential too in this endeavor, as ingredients, are ideas of nonviolence, secularism, freedom, personal and political, and democracy. Not merely as political goals for a country that has cast off the colonial yoke, but for creating a society in which women and the disadvantaged would find their rightful place. As she has said, and as I mentioned, her main character, Nayantara's main character in all her writing, has always been India, not as physical territory defined by geography, history, or religion, nor even as a civilizational entity, but as an ideal, a glittering aspiration to be realized through an active commitment to all those values that she believed were its founding and foundational values. Every one of her books explores and expands on one or other aspect of this idea of India, often by indicating just how elusive and difficult an enterprise it is, or by demonstrating how profoundly it has betrayed its promise. I have no doubt that she will write something about what's happening today. No doubt at all. this will be now the subject of her new writing, which she is doing. As she said again, to write a sort of apolitical novel wouldn't have come naturally to me. The thing is, whether I wrote fiction or non-fiction, my connection with politics was my emotional mainspring, not an event happening out there. I have been profoundly affected by it. My laughter, my tears, everything was connected with it, and there was no getting away from the emotional element in politics. I have never grown a hard shell about that. This self-conscious implication of herself in the political life of the country, a consequence both of her birth and her disposition, a deliberated choice, is what actually allowed me to attempt a biography of this very public, very well-written about woman, written about herself, which in several ways superimposed itself on a potential national biography, what I call a phantom biography of what was happening post-independence in the country. This shadow biography, obviously not something that was deliberately written in that way, but which I have read into what she writes, and based on, of course, what she said. It became very clear to me that an account of her life would be quite incomplete without reference to what was happening in the country. And I would like to suggest, and perhaps you can talk about this, that a biography of the nation via particular literary texts might throw up some quite interesting and unusual possibilities and insights. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ritu. Interesting to hear the way in which you talked us through a variety of different kinds of things, including the kinds of taking into consideration that you were struggling with, which I thought about a lot when I was reading the biography, which has been my love. Amongst a variety of diverse things, which I just want to open up here, I don't know how many of you have actually read the book, I would recommend that you go out and buy it immediately and read it. Amongst different kinds of things, when I started reading the biography, I was reminded of Yashodhara Dalmia's biography of Amrita Shetty. And there's something about women of that generation, certainly from a class background from a particular time, but that in and of itself doesn't lend itself to unconventional lives. But they are exceptional in certain ways. Yet the biography in this present moment is also struggling against not monumentalizing and not making it exceptional. So I wonder whether there were issues of that kind when you were actually writing this biography. And I was also struck by the issue of temporality. It is true, of course, the pre and post 47, but what was chilling for me reading your biography at this present moment is the current political moment, and to read about the emergency. And then when I heard her speak the other day, what was fascinating is she doesn't emphasize that. She speaks about what it means to be secular and what's actually lost. So there is a very, very fascinating set of struggles, because that is a moment of complete rupture and silencing and surveillance. And it's important not to forget that. I mean, this country has been through an extraordinary moment which actually doesn't get written about as much as it ought to. So there is something really quite fascinating there, it seemed to me. But other than that, I was wondering, you know, you're absolutely right, because, and particularly a biography of somebody like Mata Rasai, that of course is about the relationship between the individual and society, and the nation, memory and self-representation, any number of things of that kind. But there is a question which always is demanded in a way, unfairly maybe, of self-writing, which is, what does one do with the question of truth, which is always there, it's always sort of hovering. And it makes it really very interesting, and I was struck by your sort of passing reference to ethnography, because surely this is exactly the kind of question that confronts people when they do that kind of work. So I wondered whether you wanted to actually think a little bit about that. And finally, one last thing, I have 100 million things that we can chat about that later, which is, there's a way in which, say, somebody, you know, ends biographic style of a writer, by Lee Joyce, and you know, it's become the kind of modular form, as it were, to think about the way in which you write about writers. So was there something about the manner in which you were doing this, which was also speaking to the way in which there is an authoritative voice, however sort of lower down in the kind of hierarchy of writing forms biographies may be, it has a certain kind of, you know, place, and we have known biographers, as it were. So was there, were there those kinds of questions in your mind? So those are my sort of preliminary thoughts. Thank you. And now the floor is open to anybody who wishes to.
Do I need to introduce myself?
It's up to
if you wish.
I think this is the most continuous moment for me, because I've been reading your Borders and Boundaries. The book has vanished from the IIC library, it's with me, and I'm scared because I think Premola is right here. I've been reading you and now hearing you, and I think that's a very continuous moment for me. Like Arunima said, I thought it was very interesting because I do a lot of ethnography myself. There are certain ethical principles that we always talk about, right? You said that how many people do you consult, the family and stuff. So would you say they're exactly similar, like when you're writing about a particular culture, and when you're writing about a particular individual? And the second question I have is it a greater challenge to write a biography when there are several other people who have already written biographies? Would you prefer writing, be the first biographer, or is it a greater challenge to write when there are other biographies out in the market itself?
Are the biographies of the same person?
Same person.
Let me just respond to some of what you said, and this is a very interesting question. Sorry, I just very briefly respond to Arunima, because of course several, I mean, huge questions, but anyway. Monumentality. Of course, the minute you decide that you are going to write a life, it assumes a kind of monumental stature, meaning there's no way that you can actually credibly get around that. It's very difficult. With respect to Nayanthara Sehgal, actually the main challenge was not to have her overwhelmed by the Nehrus and the Gandhis. Now, it was not easy to bring that web of relationships in this very close-knit family, which was very politically visible and active, to bring that into her life, into the telling, because relationships are very, very important in her life, very important. They are of enormous significance for her. To bring all that into consideration without being overwhelmed by it. For example, she has, because it is with her to this day, almost an adoration for Nehru. It is an adoration, actually. And it was very, very difficult to not sort of, how should I put it? I could have punctured it very easily, you know, because he's a great figure, but he's no saint. And anybody who knows or who follows some amount of political, sort of developments will know that there were so many, chinks in the armor and so on and so forth. But the thing is that I was not doing a political history or a political assessment of Nehru. I was writing about his niece, about a woman for whom he became the symbol of several things that were very, very important in her life. It was the same with Gandhi. He hardly figures in my biography, but she actually had a very similar kind of valorization, idolization of Gandhi, because she is a firm and a steadfast practitioner of nonviolence, not just a believer, a practitioner. Now, there are all, so it was not simply the monumentality of the life, it was the monumentality of all those values that she held. Secularism, democracy, nonviolence, equality. I mean, all these things are monumental. All these things that, of course, I would have had to write 5 books then, meaning if I were to actually delve into her relationship with each of these, because they were an ever-present part of her writing as well as of her political landscape. So that monumentality became it was like over the shoulder all the time. But as I said, you have to find a way of truth. What is truth? Suggesting violence. I don't know if I believe in truth so much. No, there's narrative truth, of course. There is subjective truth. There is what is even called biological truth. I'm not quite sure what it means, but it's there. And so, as I say, you try to be as scrupulous as you can while telling a story. And you know, there's a lovely line that that has become almost axiomatic in writing a biography, which is, and it goes like this: lies are a part of everybody's life, and the biography must deal with those lies as much as it deals with the truth. And I certainly don't think that there is a life without lies. And how we define those lies is another area of discussion. And I want to say that with regard to your reference to Elman, and there's Elman, of course, who's A Life of Joyce has become a landmark. Before that was Lytton Strachey with Eminent Victorias, then Leslie O'Neill with Henry James, and so on. Many exceptional, exemplary biographies, but they weren't feminist. And there are not too many feminist biographies that were available or are available as models for what I was trying to do. Besides, I was breaking many rules, conventional rules of biography. I was not beginning at the beginning. I was inserting myself into the narrative. I was not going to do literary criticism. I was using a great deal of the writer's words in her own words. All of these have become are part of what has been called the troubled face of biography. These are troubled areas. These are not things that have been resolved or settled to everyone's satisfaction, or even in a satisfactory way. So, of course, it was very much part of the decision that was made. But I was very clear that I was telling a story, and that it had to read as a narrative. It could not read as a dissertation. And that's something that I wasn't. So that sort of brings me to your question. You know, when I say there's no such thing as a definitive biography, it means, of course, that there will be many biographies of the same, because they are written at different times. And when you do it at a different time, you have a whole other, I haven't even begun to speak about archive, about an archive, but it's very much part of that. Things get opened up that were not available to the first biographer. Subjects live and die. The question you raised about family consideration, very important consideration. Very, very important. And it is very important when you actually use the material that you have been able to get from family members. In what sort of balance do you strike? Whose voice, after all, will prevail? So I have to say, speaking for myself, I'd rather be the first biographer than the third or fourth. Even though you might have the benefit of, not hindsight, but retrospect, based on, you know what they say about doctors, the last doctor you consult is always the one who's right, because he's going by all the other diagnoses, all the other doctors who have seen you. But that may or may not be true of a biographer, but and I think that there is a value to being second or third or fourth down the line, but for me the exciting part is not having that as a reference already.
Direct question. Did Nayantara see the book before she published it?
No. Nor did she ever ask
because
to see.
I'm very pleased because I know that Patrick French, when he wrote the book, he didn't show it. And then you know that Patrick French,
yes,
and Yann Moulin are much of each other.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to know what.
No,
it's a very important thing when,
yes,
somebody authorizes you or just write a biography, whether they want to then look at it and say, no, these are good. So that's right. Thank you.
When she agreed, I did say that I could only do it if I had unconditional access to the material, and that she would be willing to talk, that she would be willing to I could interview her. And that she was agreeable to that. And she said, I have to say, when I said this, she said, well, of course, how else will you write it? And she never asked once to see the manuscript. Now, I have to tell you that Nayantara Sehgal's archive is an extremely extensive, very sensitive archive. That is to say, there is information there that is highly, highly liable to misuse. And if she had, if she had said that she wanted to select the material that she would give me access to, for example, Geera Sarabhai will not allow anybody to look at Mrinalini Sarabhai's papers,
exactly,
without them being screened. You know that when Aparna Basu wrote her biography,
exactly,
Geera had a third person screened the material before Aparna was allowed access to it. So this is a very common thing because you want to control the representation. Now, I have to say in Nayantara's case that there was not a single moment when she either restricted access to the material or to people. And I found that very remarkable. And to this day, as she said, at the launch, she said, well, it's not my book, it's Ritu's book. It's true, but it is her life.
Yeah. Thank you. My name is Arun Bebani. Just a prefix. I used to design my own New Year cards, and they also spoke about the country and the conditions of the country. My question to you is more because I think you'll be able to answer it. Not that I've read a book of that. That's, yeah. So it's also, I think the atmosphere is a bit too heavy. Let me try and lighten it. I have a good memory. I can also relate. It was in 1981. I was returning from Dehradun. And maybe on the cover, it was Rajiv Gandhi wearing the cap, whether the cap kicks and all. And I ran into Vijay Lakshmi Pandit Ji. Was a midway restaurant. Whatever it is. So we had a bit of a chat. You have this exceptional person, and your curiosity builds up. Maybe a couple of years after I went to Nayantara Ji, something or the other. But then, the anecdote which I'm going to tell you, a few years after that, around 86-ish, to be very exact, there was a good journalist who was talking amongst other people that Mrs. Gandhi was so, whatever. I mean, whenever we are talking about Nayantara cycle, there has to be Indira Gandhi, and there has to be Nehru. It's not. So Mrs. Gandhi was clever, publicly very, whatever you can say, smart. Then she went to Dehradun. She never liked her Goa. Whenever she went to Dehradun, and if she doesn't go to see her Goa, I mean, Vijayalakshmi Pandit, then I think she'll get a bad press. So what she would do, I want you to confirm it. What she would do, she would...
I don't confirm hearsay.
But no, that's why, because you have a... Then she would park the car in the porch, stay there for 15 minutes, half an hour, whatever is the appropriate time, and then come back without meeting Vijayalakshmi. Because she wanted to have the right kind of a image. Since you have access to her, then maybe something like that may have come. If it is not, my search will continue. Not that I'm dying for this thing, since I found the outfit and I want to do light it up there. I wish I could. Good, lots of coverage. I was in Lucknow when this thing appeared about you. Glad I'm attending this program. Thank you.
I wish I could confirm that, but I have no way to do it. I would say, though, just as a comment on your comment, that by 86, the rift between Mrs. Pandit and Mrs. Gandhi was very well known. I don't think she had to prove anything to the press.
No, I mean, I heard this in 86. I heard it
yes,
in
86. Yes, I'm saying by 86.
Maybe 10 years earlier or 5 years
part ago, I don't know for a fact. Part of the decision for Mrs. Pandit to move to Dehradun was to remove herself from Mrs. Gandhi's arena. That is to say, to move out of Delhi, out of the political sort of hot seat, into a place where there would be no such encounter that would embarrass either of them. So, as I say, if she drove into the porch and sat there, I think it would have been quite unnecessary for her to do so, because the press by then knew what was what.
But I think Vijayalakshmi Pandit was also quite a haughty person, unlike the daughter. Thank you.
I know this question. I've heard this lecture, sort of lecture, in other place also from you regarding Anitara Sabar. She herself was a great writer and she's written many novelists and all. Why she preferred biographies from other people rather than writing her own biographies? Autobiography.
She said she had already written her autobiographies. She wrote two, Prison and Chocolate Cake and From Fear Set Free. Of course, she wrote them when she was very young, so, you know, they don't really, in that sense, it was not written after a life well lived or written in when she was older. But the reason why she didn't want to write her own autobiography, she said that if I write, I want to write fiction. I'm not interested in writing about my life. It doesn't interest me in the same way. So, I mean, that, I suppose, is a perfectly valid reason.
I wasn't here when the book was launched, and so I would be very interested to hear her comments and her reactions to the book and to how you dealt with it.
You know, she's very discreet and she's also very gracious. So she was not going to be commenting on the book in public. Someone did ask, I think it was Kishwar Desai, who asked her what the relationship was between her as the subject and myself as the biographer. And her one-line reply to that was that, look, it's her book. And, you know, it has nothing to do with me in that sense. Meaning she was not going to comment in public about it. She might well comment privately, she hasn't done so yet, but she might. But in public, she would be extremely, and that's how she was. I did respond to that by saying that it's a very delicate contract between a biographer and a living subject, and also a subject whom at least I hold in very high regard. All I can say is that we're still talking to each other. So it's not like Patrick French, and when I mentioned to Nayantara that I had had enough of Delhi and I was thinking of leaving, she sent a very quick email saying, don't go too far away, we should be able to meet. So I mean, I'm not sure that, I don't know, I really don't know how, I can't speak for her.
The other part of the question was, you mentioned how you have to be cautious about other family members and their reaction. Did you actually need to have anything that you wish to say vetted by anyone?
No, nobody. No, none of the children whom I spoke to, and I spoke to each of them individually, wanted to vet. There were certain factual things that I asked them to corroborate or to correct or to clarify. These were matters of fact, like when their father passed away, for example, was there a funeral, where did it take place, etc., etc., things like that. And certain dates, which I wasn't sure of and which Nayantara herself wasn't sure of. So, for example, when Gautam Sehgal, her first husband, remarries, I wasn't sure exactly when it happened. And so, of course, I did ask the children. And that kind of stuff, yes. But I have to say that each of them spoke individually, independently to me, and I asked many of the same questions to them about relationships. That's, as I say, it's a very critical part of the writing, or at least of understanding her life. I don't think that there was any holding back. And actually, if you read the book, you will see how candidly they spoke. There was one person who refused to talk to me, and that was Gautam Sehgal, Nayantara's first husband's younger sister. She said, "I want to have nothing to do with this." And so, but her son did. So, you know, it's like that. You win some, you lose some.
Did she ever write a diary? Then the problem about dates wouldn't really be so much.
She wrote a diary, which she destroyed.
But she has to write. And also, I'm kind of interested to know, how do you end a biography of a living person?
You know?
How difficult is it to come to a kind of, you know, we know the usual ones where people talk about their contributions to social life and stuff, but then how do you sort of...
No, what I did actually was, of course, you're very right, how do you end it? How do you end your story? I mean, the life is continuing, but you have to put a closure to it somewhere. And I decided that I would end it with the last novel she wrote, and with the death of both her first husband and her second husband. That there was a kind of closure there, which I saw, that provided, I can't say it's the best possible ending, but it provided a kind of ending. And of course, you know, she will continue to write, she continued to publish. She has published 3 books since then, not novels, but 3 other books. But, you know, one can't keep it open-ended as a project.
Yeah, this is slightly personal, but me being a student of English literature and an aspiring writer, I would like to understand the mindset or the stimulation of a biographer.
Like, stimulation?
Yeah. What stimulated you to write a biography?
The subject?
Yeah.
She herself.
Yeah, but
I mean, if you're not excited by the subject, you can't write about it, actually. And it shows in the writing.
So
I mean, if you're tired in your, in the relationship you have, either with the subject or with her work or with the research, there's no way it won't creep into the writing. So I think that is a very important aspect of writing a life.
Yeah, but you being a writer, you wrote a book on a writer.
I'm not that kind of writer. I'm a very prosaic writer. I don't have that. I don't have no imagination. I could never write a work of fiction, for example. Never. I wouldn't know what to do with it. No, I'm not that kind of writer. She is. So, you know, it wasn't that there was never any there was never any competition there.
have lots of questions, but I think I'm getting too much. I'm becoming like the subject of so.
I'm doing my PhD at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver. At the Department of Center for, it's a very long sentence, Center for Gender, Race, Sexuality and Social Justice.
And you've got it all.
But the thing is that I'm basically an applied mathematician by discipline. So I'm really looking more for facts, and that drew me into this whole field of, like you, I've been very fascinated with biography, but with mostly Bengali. There are lots of good biographies in Bangla, and it's a shame that we have not been able to translate many of them. I've talked about this at the Science Academy, and they have always said that, like you said, that biographies, how is that a different genre from, you know, historical writings or life writings? So, but my interest really grew out of, it's not so much a voyeuristic, it's like reading about times. There's so much more interesting. And I'm looking right now for my PhD thesis at a partition through the lives, through the archival reading. And rigorous Sarabhai's entire documents have been taken back by her family. So
yeah, they won't allow
me. They will not allow me that, but Rameshwari Nehru, yes.
Yes, those are available. Those are.
But there are certain diaries of some of these people who worked in the Bengal partition. And fascinating facts that are coming out. So I was interested in knowing if she would answer why she destroyed her diary.
Who?
The Nayankara Sai from the
husband's jealousy. Very simple. She makes no secret of any of this. He was jealous of
first husband.
First husband, yes.
Okay.
She destroyed lots of letters. Many people do this, you know. I mean, it's not, now I can say this because it's also as good. Padmaja Naidu destroyed hundreds of letters from Nehru to her. Hundreds. Zora Sehgal destroyed all the correspondence between her and Uday Shankar. Women do this. What is remarkable about Nayantara's archive is what she has preserved. That is also something very. But letters, people destroy. Women especially destroy. I mean, can you imagine Padmaja Naidu destroying 300 letters from Nehru to her? Just destroyed. Zora, I asked her, I said, why did you do? She said, nahi, Dada. She used to call him Dada, Uday Shankar. She said, Dada ne bola, jala do sab, maine jala diya. Prithviraj Kapoor's letters are still with her. Beautiful letters. In beautiful Urdu. When we published her memoirs, we had some of them translated. Very lovely letters from Prithviraj to her. Very beautiful. She's kept those because, anyway, that's another story.
You know, emails, things will get destroyed because
yes,
the
now
system
this is
will crash.
The thing, you see, what will be an archive for the future is a question that that one must address, and as I said, in have time to talk about that, but it is it's very important in biography to know what archive you can reach.
But it is an interesting question that we imagine we should have complete access to somebody's diary, whereas we wouldn't want to share ours.
Yes,
so
yes.
The way we position ourselves vis-a-vis other people's lives is quite
absolutely
fascinating, but I think somebody had a question.
Please elaborate on the shadow biography slash phantom biography.
You know, I haven't given it any very great thought, let's say. So, you know, I'll have to give you only a very tentative, provisional reply. It's something along the lines of what I said when I started about, can one write a biography of a movement? It's a very elusive thing. It's not something you can capture with any degree of what used to be called veracity or credibility or whatever, you know, all those objectivity, all those things. Now, one of the reasons that Kamala and I began to write about the partition was that we were totally dissatisfied with the narrative as it had come to us through history, through
even through literature, let's say, but literature in a much less authoritative way than history. How do you write it again? How do you write it differently? That becomes the question. What do you do to write it differently, or to write it, to write another history? And actually, that, in a way, I suppose, was like a shadow story of partition. Naitara said something very interesting in response to a question someone asked her about politics and her writing, because she's always said she writes good. And she said, there's no such thing as putting politics into fiction. That's not what political writing is about. But fiction is about what happens in people's lives as a consequence of what's happening in the political life of the country. Okay. And therefore, she says, there is no closure in fiction, because there is no closure in the political life of the country. So that's what she meant when she spoke about politics in her writing. So I suppose, in a roundabout way, what I'm trying to get at is that through her fiction as well as her political writing, you get a kind of picture of what is happening in the country through certain selected epical events. For example, the linguistic division of states. She deals with it. The division of Punjab into Haryana and Punjab, and Chandigarh being the capital for both, she deals with it. These are very important events in the life of the country, very, very significant in the life of the country. She deals with what happens when political personages fall out with each other. What happens to policy? What happened to the petroleum policy when the government decided that they were going with the Russians, not with the Americans? A very important aspect of what was happening in the country, the emergency. The Naxal movement. She writes about the Naxal movement because that became a very, very important event in the 70s. Late 60s, 70s. That's why I said she would definitely write about Modi's government. Now, not about RSS high quality impact on people's lives. And I think that the book that she wrote on the Naxal movement, which is a situation in Delhi, is one of the few that dealt with the crisis in education. We talk about it now. Everybody's talking about the crisis in education. You open one paper and you get five articles on the ground. This was written in 71, when there didn't seem to be a crisis in education. But she dealt with it. And she dealt with student unrest, with the student movement, and going into extremism, what was called extremism, which she found a perfectly valid political political direction. So that, I suppose, is what I mean by it. So I not in any very clearly worked out way, but as a possibility. That's why I said it's a possibility.
Thank you so much, Ritu. Thank you, everybody, for this. Thank you.